I spend when I kneel in prayer, and in thee, my Lord, I commune as friend with friend. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. I love the words of that last stanza where it says, when I kneel in prayer and with thee, my God, I commune as friend with friend. There's not a better feeling than just knowing that God, when you talk to him through prayer, it's like talking to a friend. It's even better than talking to your wife or your husband, because they know that day maybe you didn't treat them as good as usual, but they are happy that you talk to them. But imagine God when you talk to him as friend with another friend. Let's sing our last hymn, 532, Day by Day. And for that one, let's all stand. When we're seated, we're comfortable, and sometimes not all the air out of our lungs comes out. But when we're standing, we can sing like kids. Day by day, and with each passing moment, strength I find to meet my trials here. Trusting in my Father's wise bestowment, I've no cause for worry and for fear. He whose heart is kind beyond all measure gives anew each day what seems it best. Loving part of pain and pleasure, mingling toil with peace and rest. Every day the Lord himself is near me with a special mercy for each hour. All my cares he fain would bear and cheer me. He whose name is Counselor and Power, the protection of his child and treasure, is a charge that on himself he laid. As your days, your strength shall be in measure, this a pledge to me made. Help me then in every tribulation, so to trust thy promises, O Lord, that I lose not faith, sweet consolation offered me within thy holy word. Help me, Lord, when toil and troubles meeting, e'er to make as from the Father's hand. One by one the days and moments fleeting, till I reach the promised land. Amen. We can all be seated.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. I want to welcome you to Tridelphia Seventh-day Adventist Church, those of you who are here present and those who are online. For me, this is a special treat, not just because we're entering some other realms, as you will see today, but because I'm home. I've been traveling for a while, so I feel welcome to be at home and to be with you. And I pray that the Lord will bless all of you, those who are here and those who are listening and those who are watching as well. We have some announcements, and I will first direct you to the bulletin. In the back, you will see that we have requests for prayer, for health, for workers abroad and others. And we also have potluck today, and you're all invited to be participants there. We have a baby dedication that's coming up. The Howard County Fair will be talked about in a little while. The Pathfinders Camporee Bible Study with the Williams on Wednesdays. And, of course, we have some specific announcements. Ted, you can go first.
Good morning, people of God. When Jesus was starting his ministry, there were a couple of disciples of John's that followed him, and they asked him, anyone remember? Where are you staying? What did he say? Come and see. And later on, there was a discussion between Nathaniel and, who was it? Andrew? Philip. And he said, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? And the reply was, come and see. We are in August, as we have many Augusts. We are going to be setting up a booth at the Howard County Fair. This year, we want specifically for that to be our theme. Not to go and, you know, set an agenda or anything, but simply to put before the world, before the people who are there, the love of God, and let them come and see this amazing person that we have come to know. We're trying something a little different this time around. Rather than making this a thing for the extroverts, we're going to try the introvert method, which is, if you want to just come and make sure that the literature is set out, we are going to have information available about health, about families, and we're going to have Bibles specifically available that people can just come and take, free Bibles. And you would just want to be there and maybe answer questions if someone asks you a question, but otherwise just be there. This is an opportunity for you to come and to just be quiet and to let the Spirit of God work. We need people to sign up. This is happening from the 3rd through the 10th, which is a time that a lot of people will be away from here. The Pathfinders are going to be out on the Camporee, and we're going to have, what is it, ASI also happening at that same time. So we definitely need people more than usual, but I think we don't have to be as active in the booth. We can come and just be there and let people come and see. So I'm going to be sending around sign-up sheets. If you would like to come and spend some hours just sharing or just being there as the Holy Spirit works in people's lives, please come join us.
Thank you. Albert, you had an announcement.
We are going to have a deacon's meeting soon after the service. And also, I'm asking those people who live close to church, what's the definition of close to church? 20 minutes or less? Or whatever you feel. If you live 1.5 hours away from here and you feel you're close to church, this is your meeting. So see you after the service.
Thank you. This morning for our call to worship, I'll be reading from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 12 to 17. You can open your Bibles with me if you wish. Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand, or with the breadth of his hand marked off the heavens? Who has held the dust of the earth in a basket, or weighed the mountains on the scales and the hills in a balance? Who has understood the mind of the Lord or instructed him as his counselor? Who did the Lord consult to enlighten him? And who taught him the right way? Who was it that taught him knowledge or showed him the path of understanding? Surely the nations are like a drop in a bucket. They are regarded as dust on the scales. He weighs the islands as though they were fine dust. Lebanon is not sufficient for altar fires, nor its animals enough for burnt offerings. Before him, all the nations are as nothing. They are regarded by him as worthless and less than nothing. Yet we're glad that God considers us, even us. Let us pray. To the extent possible, I'd invite you to kneel. Father in heaven, we're thankful that you don't just reside in heaven, but you come down to meet us, and that we can reach out to you in prayer as a family, as a church family. We're also glad that we don't need any special technology to be able to reach you. You are the technology. And we know that you hear our prayers and more than willing to answer according to your grace. Lord, we're here to worship you this morning, and we ask that you will cleanse this place of any evil influences, especially the influence of the evil one, that we'll be able to listen and participate and bask in your presence, that the things of earth will grow strangely dim as we look and see and hear and sing and experience your presence with us. We pray for the pastor as he speaks this morning, Elder Joe, and for the children who will be participating as well. We pray that we'll be transported to the courts of heaven, not the courts of Babylon, and that you will give us something today that will be a balm for us as we go into the weeks and months ahead and prepare us better for when you come to take us home. We have sick among us. We have people who are hurting in all kinds of ways, and we present them to you now. We ask as well for the activities that we have in the community. We pray that we might be lights shining on a hill. And Lord, when all is said and done, we pray that none who is in the hearing of my voice will be lost, and that when you come to take your people home, we all will be counted among that number. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's all stand as we sing together hymn number 518, Standing on the Promises. Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal stages praises ring. Glory in the highest, I will shout and sing. Standing on the promise, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail, when the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord. Bound to Him, external by the law of accord. Overcoming daily with the Spirit's word. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
You may be seated. We have a special privilege this morning, as we have every Sabbath, of sharing what we have been blessed with. And, you know, we are a worldwide family. The church is really a family, and we have fellow believers in at least 212 countries around the world, and over 23 million around the world. And as you might imagine, there are lots of different needs around the world. In Sabbath School this morning, we were just looking at a wonderful story from Costa Rica, where actually our daughter Heather happens to be right now. She's in Costa Rica. And there was an orphanage for abandoned children, and a family was praying that God would send them a child. And actually, one of the children, a girl from this orphanage, asked if they would adopt her. And they saw that as a sign from the Lord. She was adopted, grew up as part of their family. She's now studying nursing at Central American Adventist University in Costa Rica. And it was a remarkable story, but these stories could be multiplied countless times in countless ways about how God is working in lots of different places around the world. And so our offering this morning is for the world budget, which, as I mentioned, goes to lots of different needs worldwide. And may the Lord bless all the offerings that are collected this morning for those needs. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Our loving Father in heaven, we thank you for how you have blessed us individually and as a church family worldwide. There are so many, many things that, Lord, we don't quite grasp about how your work moves forward so rapidly, so fully, except it's by your power, by your Spirit. And we thank you, Lord, for the many good things that we see happening. And now as the offering are taken up this morning, we ask for your blessing upon them, that they will go just to where it's needed most. And thank you for the privilege of sharing. In Jesus' name, amen. The deacons will now wait upon us. So we also have a special offering for our children. As you can see, they're very important to us. We have somehow tried to make that clear. And now is the opportunity for us to share also with the children who will come around with baskets for Christian education, Seventh-day Adventist Christian education. So you're invited to share when they come around.
And as we usually do, let's open our hymn books in hymn 218. And as the children gather the offering for Adventist education, let's sing together. He cometh when he cometh to make up his jewels. Oh, the jewels, precious jewels, he loved and his own. Like the stars in the morning, his bright crown adorning, they shall shine in their beauty, bright. He will gather the gems for his kingdom. All the pure ones, all the bright ones, he loved as his own. Like the stars of the morning, his bright crown adore him. They shall shine in their beauty, bright gems for his crown. Little children, who love their Redeemer, as the jewels, precious jewels, he loved and his own. Like the stars of the morning, his bright crown adorning, they shall shine in their beauty, bright gems for his crown.
Hello, boys and girls, and everybody else. It's so good to see you all today. Today, we're going to have a combo of a children's story where I'm going to be reviewing what we learned this last week and also having the children come up and help me to tell a little bit about some of the things we learned this week. So, and at the end of the program, everybody who was at VBS, you're going to get a special certificate with your name on it, telling how you were here at VBS, and we were very excited you were here at VBS. We'll have it at the back, so you can pick it up at the back. Okay, so on the first night of VBS, we had a very special story where we learned about four friends. What were their names? Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, also known as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Very good. And we learned that they chose to eat good food or bad food?
Good.
That's right. The second day, we learned about a special statue. And this special statue was, who dreamed of it? Was it the king! King Nebuchadnezzar, that's right! And he had a head of?
Gold.
Chest and arms of?
Silver.
Belly and thigh of?
Glass.
Legs of?
Iron.
Feet of?
Iron
and clay. And we had that represented Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, Rome, divided kingdoms, lots of kingdoms. And do you know what? Was it the wise men who could answer his question, or was it Daniel who trusted God who could answer his question?
Daniel.
Let's try that again. Was it the wise men who could answer his dream or Daniel who could answer his dream?
Daniel.
That's right. And because he trusted God, right? The third night, we learned about how King Nebuchadnezzar didn't like that there was going to be lots of kingdoms and wanted it all to be Babylon. So what did he have the men do who didn't bow down? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. What did he do with them? He threw them into a fiery furnace, into the fire. And if you guys were here that night, we had a fire that had smoke, and it was great fun. And the kids very much enjoyed that. But I was going to bring it up and show you guys, but I couldn't get it up today because it's part of my program downstairs. So there's no fiery furnace up here. But did they burn up or did God save them?
God saved them.
That's right, because when we stand for God, he stands for us. That's right. On night four, we learned about another very sad story, and I didn't bring that one up either, but the sad story was of King Belshazzar. Did King Belshazzar learn from Nebuchadnezzar's mistakes? No. And did he humble himself or was he proud? He was proud. And what was he doing? Was he choosing good things or did he choose to do some things that were not good? Not good. And they made him make some very sad choices, right? That's right. Do we want to choose to do good things or do we want to make sad choices? Good choices. That's right. We want to make good choices. And then our last day, we learned about how Daniel, what did he do every day, three times a day? What did he do? That's right. He prayed and asked God to be with him. And even when he was going to be thrown into a lion's den, every single day he went up to his window. And what did he do?
Prayed.
That's right. And did God protect him in the lion's den?
Yes.
Because when we stand for God, he stands for us. So I would like you all to come up. Those of you who are in VBS, come on up, and we're going to say our memory verses that we learned this week to show the moms and dads how we've been learning how God is faithful to us. So come on up. We're going to stand on this side of the statue. Right over. Tall kids in the back, shorter ones in the front, or littler ones in the front. Two memory verses, yes. Okay, come on up. You ready? You want me to tell them? Okay, we learned two memory verses this week, and we're going to share them with you as soon as the kids come up. We learned two verses, and Mr. Deriba helped the kids in the memory verse section to memorize them. And can we scooch just a little bit this way? We're going to be on this side of the statue here. Okay. Okay. Are you guys ready? Okay. We can't see you, Leo. Can you scoot up, buddy? Can't see you. There we go. We gotta see you too. Okay, are you ready? Go ahead. Great job, guys. Now stay up here because it's time for our special music and we're going to sing our theme song. Oh, I'm so sorry. We're going to sing our theme song. So go ahead and stand up and we're going to sing Dare to be a Daniel, the first verse, and we're going to sing it twice. And the second time, you guys can join us for our second time we're singing it.
Dare to be a Daniel.
Thank you so much. You may go be seated with your parents. Thank you so much. Oh, wait. I'm so sorry. They have some coloring pages for you right over here. I forgot to remind you of that. Okay. Quick slideshow that shows what we've been doing at VBS this week. So we're very excited about it. So go ahead and turn your attention to the screen, and we will be showing what we did this week. It's very fun.
Hi, my name's Vicky.
My name's Cornelius.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is.
Okay, welcome to this year's VBS.
Let's meet the staff. Who am I here with?
Kiana.
What is your occupation?
I'm a group leader for Alliance.
Thank you. Who am I here with?
Sue.
What is your occupation?
To take care of my kids.
Who are your kids?
The Rams.
Thank you for your time.
Who am I here with?
London.
Okay, hi London. So what do you do here at VBS?
I am a group leader for the Bears. They are very interesting people to work with. And they have been fun and interesting to lead through the church.
Thank you for your time. Who am I here with?
I'm Theron.
And what do you do here at VBS, Theron?
I'm a group leader for the Leopards.
I'm here with...
Reba Olana.
And what is your job at VBS?
Okay, so I'm here in the... Let me try to read... It's called the Scripture Memory Room for this week. And it's where the kids come to do like the memory challenge. So they have to memorize scripture, which means I have to memorize it. That's the hardest part.
So who am I with?
Alicia.
And what is your job here?
I'm doing the games at VBS.
And what is that like?
That has been very, very great. It has been really nice. I was running the games with my husband, Ricky, and we've also had Egan and Daniel Villela help out, and we're just getting the kids to run around and have a great time.
Thank you for your time.
You're welcome.
Who am I with?
Joe Reeves.
And what is your job at VBS?
I have helped organize it with an awesome team of volunteers, and then also leading the character station. We've had goats out there, fire, and a lot of fun with the kids.
So, who am I here with?
I'm Ruthie.
And what do you do here at VBS?
I am the general master of ceremonies, storyteller, and gopher.
So, who am I with?
I'm Miss Wahlen.
And what do you do here at VBS?
I do crafts.
And what's that like?
It's super fun. I love it. And we do a lot of cool things with construction paper, with glue, scissors, markers, wood boxes, paper plates. It's super fun.
Who am I with?
Hi, I'm Sylvia.
And I'm Peggy.
And what do you do at VBS?
We are doing registration.
We have to recognize all the kids and write out the name cards for them.
Thank you for your time.
I'm here with
Miss Tracy.
And what do you do to help with VBS?
I play the piano for the music program.
Who am I with?
I'm Angela.
And what do you do at VBS?
I'm in charge of the kitchens, all the meals and prepping, cleaning up. But I have lots of helpers. I have Peggy and Gail and Roxanne, and Michelle and Ryan and Susan and Stefania, so thank you guys all for your help. Goodbye.
Daniel's.
of temperance shown by the Hebrew youth, God is speaking to the youth of today. There is need of men who, like Daniel, will do and dare for the cause of right. Pure hearts, strong hands, fearless courage are needed, for the warfare between vice and virtue calls for ceaseless vigilance. Our scripture reading is found in Daniel 7, verse 13 and 14. And it reads, I was watching in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and language should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom the one which shall not be destroyed.
And the kids, we've had lots of smiles and lots of tired parents and lots of great memories, and we've just been having a great time having fun together and learning and making new friends and going deeper. Our theme has been Dare to Be, and we are going to continue that theme from Daniel this morning, and I have some of the young participants from VBS who are going to help me at various parts of the message. So buckle your seatbelts. This is going to be a great time. By the way, we have some great youth in this church. Caitlin did that slideshow. Masterful job. And our young people that led our groups, Theron and Kiana and Sue, Sunny, yes, awesome job. London, we got some awesome youth, and it's not just my opinion, but that's what everybody else has been telling me, and so we've been having a great time. I'd like to ask for prayer, and we're going to learn more about the book of Daniel this morning. We've been learning about a man who was not in Babylon willingly. He was taken there, him and his friends, and we've got a lot to learn from Daniel, who was in Babylon, who was faithful in Babylon. Because today we're also living in a place that sounds a lot like Babylon. In Babylon, there was lots of good music. I take out the word good. There was lots of music. There was lots of banqueting. There was lots of gold. There was lots of food, lots of parties. And it's much like the cities of our world today. And if God's ever needed Daniels, he is calling boys and girls today who will stand for him and who will be faithful in faithful no matter what's happening in Babylon. Let's pray. If you bow your heads. Heavenly Father, as we read some scriptures this morning and as we consider the things that you have taught us and we wrap up this great week, may you speak to our hearts again that we may dare to be boys and girls, moms and dads, grandmas and grandpas that are here, all of us want to tune in and respond to your call today. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. When Daniel was hauled off to Babylon, it was a sad, sad day. And they tied him up, and they lined him up, and they marched him across the desert. You think Daniel was crying? He was just a young boy when he was saying goodbye to his home to never see it again, taken away from his parents. He was young. I don't know. The Bible doesn't say his exact age. He may have been 14, 15, 16, 17. He was young, and there he was being taken off. But as he was taken to Babylon, he purposed in his heart, boys and girls, just a young man, he purposed in his heart that he was going to stay faithful to God no matter what happened in Babylon. And that's why we have the book of Daniel today. The stories from the book of Daniel give us much courage. They challenge us. And the prophecies give us many reasons to believe and to have a strong faith and a strong hope in God. And so
Today we are going to be looking at Daniel chapter 7. When Daniel was in the midst of Babylon, and one night when he was there, long ways away from his homeland, and he saw in the visions of the night something that disturbed him terribly. So you can turn in your Bibles to Daniel chapter 7, where we will look at what was happening with Daniel way back then. And Babylon, by the way, I have some pictures on the screen, and beautiful pictures. That's one done by Adventist artist Steve Kreitz, and a picture of the Ishtar Gate and of the gardens of Babylon, the river running through, the security, the big walls, the opulence, the wealth, the parties, the leisure. It was a great place to be in the eyes of the world. But Daniel did not feel at home in Babylon. That's where he was, but every day he looked towards Jerusalem, and every day he bowed down before the God of heaven, and he prayed, and he says, I will never forget who I am. I will never forget where I came from. I will never forget my God, and I'm going to worship him and him only. And so no matter what was happening outside those windows, Daniel kept his connection with God. Boys and girls, do you think that's what we need today? Men and women, moms and dads, a strong connection with God no matter how much crazier the world is getting out there. And so as he saw in his dream that night, and there was a great sea, and he saw coming up out of the sea all these wild animals that were coming up out of the sea. And I'm not talking about whales or about dolphins, but these animals that were just rising up out of the sea. This was his dream. God was showing him the things that were about to happen and about to appear, where he was at and what was to come through these prophecies. So, first, I'm going to call some help up. I have made a new friend this morning, Raphael. Can you come up and help me? And Nico, can you come up? And I've made a lot of new friends at VBS this week, and I also made a new friend in Sabbath school this morning, Raphael. Can you wave at everybody? All right, stand right up here on this first step, and all right, Abigail. Okay, can you guys stand right up here? And can you hold, you can both hold the chair. Hold it really tall for everybody to see this amazing lion. Now, come on, guys. We got to have some Adventist kind of teddy bears these days, right? This is what it's all about. Now, read to us, Abigail, what the prophet saw rising up out of the sea.
The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. Then as I looked, its wings were plucked off, and it was lifted up from the ground and made to stand on 2 feet like a man, and the mind of a man was given to it. Daniel 4:7. No, 7:4.
7:4. Yeah. Thank you, Abigail. And when he saw that, now some of us maybe, has anybody ever seen a lion before? Yeah. Okay. Lions are real serious. You can share it here together with Nico. But has anybody ever seen a lion with wings? In a movie, huh? Oh, this was like a movie for Daniel, except this was shown right down from heaven with these symbols. And Daniel recognized it right away. And so when he saw this winged lion, he actually had seen them before around in his time. And because when I was in London in December, I went to the British Museum, and I took this picture with my phone right there, that which came from Babylon. And they depicted themselves right there, and that lion is a funny one because what does it have on it? You see the wings, and boy, he's got a nice expression on his face, doesn't he? And then they had one more at the British Museum. This one has a different kind of face. Are you ready for this one? Oh, that one came from Babylon as well. Looking like a lion with wings. But more importantly than that, Daniel remembered the prophet Jeremiah. And so we read from the prophet Jeremiah, chapter 4. You're almost done, guys. You're doing real good. Hold it up high while I read this. In Jeremiah chapter 4, where the prophet Jeremiah was talking about the invaders coming from the north because they came around the desert, dropped down from the north. It was the Babylonian armies, and he saw them like a lion. Jeremiah 4, verse 7, the lion has come up from his thicket. And so Daniel knew that that first beast represented Babylon. All right, can you take a seat? Thank you so much for helping me. Now, you can put it right over there, Raphael. Thank you. Be sure to come to Sabbath school in the morning because Sabbath school is a good place to make new friends. And in Sabbath school, we are learning the stories of the Bible so that for our young people, they have some different kinds of heroes than what they're finding in the world. Oh, yes, out in the world, there's all kinds of people following the people of this world, the heroes. But we don't need to be having the sports stars, the singers, the entertainers be the great people in our kids' minds. Let's teach them the stories of the Bible so that they know where they're headed and they have something higher to aim for. What do you think? So my sister just came back from Masimara just a couple days ago. And they took a lot of pictures there. And this is a video that she took. And do you see what's in the grass there? Lions are serious. If you're around a lion, you better watch very carefully what's happening. That was last week. She took that video right there. That's a wildebeest. Got it. So if I ever went to Masimara, if there was lions there that had wings, I would only go if I was in an armored vehicle. I do not want lions having wings. And Babylon had a very proud, very lifted up view of themselves. And indeed, they were a great and wealthy nation. But this was not the only beast that came up out of the sea. Next comes a bear. And Hudson and Misha, can you come over and lift this up? And Naor, can you come up and read to us about the second animal that rises up out of the sea?
And behold, there was another beast, a second one, like a bear. It was raised up on one side. It had three ribs in its mouth between its teeth, and it was told, "Arise, devour much flesh." Daniel 7:5.
All right, thank you. Keep holding that up. Keep holding that up. Stand right there. And that bear is a special one. He's got three little bones in his mouth. They're ribs. And we need to have the manufacturers put a little more stuffing on this side because this was a lopsided bear, the Bible says. And he comes up, and the next kingdom that came after Babylon was Medo-Persia. You can look them up online, the Medes and the Persians. The Medes were early, but the Persians became the strongest. The Medes came in and took over Babylon, but the Persians established their strength, and so it was a lopsided beast. Now, this special animal, you guys can sit down because I want you to see this picture I have on my screen. This is one that my sister took up in Alaska, and where I grew up in Washington State, we didn't have Kodiak bears. We had a lot of brown bears, and they were very, very powerful. One time I pulled behind one with my Suburban. I was driving, and that bear was lumbering down the road. They can actually run pretty fast. I was chasing him about 25 miles an hour. But this animal is very strong. And so Persia had huge armies, large navies, and they were able to establish dominance like never before. But that's not the last beast that arises. So next we have JJ and Imani here. You come on over, Imani. You got to help JJ. You got to hold up what we get to see next. Stand right up here and hold it really high because this one looks funny. Everybody's got to see what it looks like. And Daniel, you got this one. Read to us what this third beast was about that rose up out of the sea.
After this, I looked, and behold, another like a leopard with four wings of a bird on its back. And the beast had four heads, and dominion was given to it. Daniel 7:6.
Thank you. All right. Now, leopards. Are leopards dangerous? Oh, yeah. They can be. This leopard has four wings. That's too many. Have you ever seen an animal with four wings? And four heads. Have you seen one like that in the zoo? This was a different kind. And we find out from this prophecy and the next prophecy that this kingdom rises up. When it rises up, it's very united under one head with Alexander the Great. And when he dies, they continue. They become even more fierce after they've established their dominion. But it's divided between the generals. Two of the generals caused a lot of problems in Jerusalem. There was Ptolemy in the south in Egypt, and the Seleucus in the north, and there was also Cassander and Lysimachus on the wings, east and west. And those four generals, they made Greece more powerful than ever, and Greece established a lot of philosophy with Plato and Aristotle. But do you guys want to see one of these kinds of animals in the middle of the night? No, I don't think so. Thank you for sitting down. And my sister also took this video last week of a leopard. And this leopard was at the top of a tree, and he's going to come down very, very carefully. Why? Because he does not have four wings. I am so glad he does not have four wings, or he could come right at you. Oh, he's got to balance very carefully. He does not want to fall, does he? He's calculating every single move. But can you see the spots on his skin, how beautiful he is? Beautiful, beautiful color, isn't he? All right, he changed his mind on that one. Yeah, it's a little easier to go down with your feet first, isn't it? Yeah. Now he has a hard decision to make. Very hard decision to make. There he is. He's down. Leopards are very serious animals, aren't they? And they are very sneaky. All right. And then the fourth great and terrible beast was worse than all of them. I bet you're waiting for my video on that one, aren't you? Who else did I have? Is Connor in the room? Come on, Connor. Come on, man. Come on, you got this. You got this. And Mati, can you come up? Stand right up here. Hold that real high. That's the great and terrible beast from Daniel 7. Stand on the top step right there and let everybody see. And by the way, if you can't see, if you don't have binoculars today, if you didn't bring those to church, This little horn's got a frowny face on it, and we might find out while we're reading this. Thank you, Monty.
After this, I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, terrifying and dreadful, and exceedingly strong. It had great iron teeth. It devoured and broke in pieces and stamped what was left with its feet. It was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another horn, a little one, before which 3 of the first horns were plucked up by the roots, and behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things.
Thank you, Monty. That's quite a description. Stay here for a second, Connor. Hold this thing up real high. Thank you. You can sit down. This was called the Great and the Terrible Beast. This was mightier and stronger than ever. And he had, what did it have? Iron teeth. And he was stomping the ground, and he was mighty. And Connor, what does he have on the top of his head? He's got all these horns. Anybody remember how many horns? 10 horns. And then this little rascal horn, he comes up and he uproots 3 of the horns. And thank you, Connor, thank you for the help. He uproots 3 of the horns, and then he persecutes the saints for a long time. He speaks pompous words, and he has the eyes of men. Sorry I don't have a video for that one. But my Adventist artists do help us out a little bit. This is Steve Kreitz again. And so this was the most fierce compared to all of them. And indeed, after Greece fell, what was the big empire that came after that? Rome. Everybody that knows about Rome, if you know anything about Western civilization. Because when they came, they were in charge. Do you remember who was in charge when Jesus was on earth? It was Rome. Oh, yes. And they were not always very nice. And they had a lot of taxes, and they had a lot of soldiers that would make people walk and carry their burdens and help them out. And all of these powers persecuted God's people. They caused fear. During the time of Greece, there was a lot of persecution. There was a time of death, war in Jerusalem, until the Maccabees rised up and pushed back. And then out of his head, here we go. What's this guy called? The little horn. And it's a big contradiction when the Bible calls it a little horn. Because in verse 20 it says, his appearance was greater than his fellows. So how can he be smaller than the rest, but greater than the rest? Well, that's because that's exactly what happened. Because after the breakup of the Roman Empire, there was one city in Europe, one city that became the most important city, the most important city it's been in Europe for over 2,000 years. The smallest, little, and the greatest, because they have the most influence and power. It's because of Rome's special recipe, mixing church and state, and bringing this power together so that the other kings in Europe are very afraid of what the king in Rome says, what also known as the Pope, who wears the crown right there in the Vatican. And right there from this city emanated, they didn't have their own armies, but they lifted themselves against God and the things that were taught, teaching people to pray to saints instead of Jesus, teaching people to buy their way to salvation through indulgences, and getting in between people and Jesus. And so, as we look at Daniel chapter 7, let's read a couple other verses as we consider what the importance of this message is. It describes the activity of the fourth beast, the ten horns and the little horn, in verses 23 to 25. You can consider those with me. Daniel 7, verse 23 to 25. Thus he said, the fourth beast shall be a fourth what? Kingdom. And so we've been right. Every single beast represents a kingdom or a nation. That comes right from the Bible. The fourth kingdom, though, shall be different from all other kingdoms and shall devour the whole earth, trample it, and break it in pieces. The ten horns, or ten kings, who shall arise from this kingdom, and another shall arise after them. And he shall be different from the first ones and shall subdue three kings. That's why Rome was larger than all of the previous ones. They ruled all of the Mediterranean, the joining of the three continents, North Africa, parts of Asia, and practically all of Europe, all the way up into England and Great Britain. They ruled it all. But after that fell apart, all these little horns appeared. And then there's this little horn that's different from the first ones. And the little horn shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute the saints of the Most High, shall intend to change times and law, and the saints shall be given into his hand for a time, times, and half a time. So this little horn's not just attacking the other nations around, but there's an attack against God's law. There's an attack against God's time, and an attack on the Sabbath, and an attack on the second commandment, and others. And there was much persecution. Our English Bibles that we hold in our hand, the first people that translated it risked their lives to do it. John Wycliffe died a natural death, but he was so much hated by the official church that his bones were dug up and they were burned 40 years later and thrown in the river. And then when William Tyndale did the first English translation from the original languages of Hebrew and Greek, he was burned to the stake. He gave his life for giving us the first English translation of the Bible from the original languages. And that was repeated all across Europe in different places. You know, when we consider Daniel chapter 7, we have not read about the hero of Daniel 7 yet. So we finish the chapter out in verse 26 and 27. Because now comes the important word, but. All of these nations around the world, not just these four, are putting pressure against God's people. But the court shall be seated, and they shall take away his dominion to consume and destroy it forever. And the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdoms under the whole heaven shall be given to the people, the saints of the Most High. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. And who's him? It's Jesus. It's God. And because of Daniel 7, Daniel 7 puts all of the nations of this world into their proper perspective. It's because of Daniel that Jesus stood before his disciples when they were so enthralled and their hearts were just bubbling over with national pride because of this great national monument of the temple in Jerusalem. And the white, beautiful marble and the sun reflecting on it. And they said, Jesus, do you not see these beautiful stones? And in Matthew 24, and in the first three verses, Jesus says, you know, not one stone shall be left upon another. How does Jesus know that? Well, later in the chapter, in verse 15, he told them, read Daniel. If you've read The Abomination of Desolation, let him who reads understand. When you read the book of Daniel, it puts your life, your family, your nation, your world into its proper perspective. Because the temple's not going to last forever. And of course, the temple in Jerusalem's not the only city in the world built out of white marble. Right here in Washington, D.C., we love our buildings that stand for our national institutions of America. And there's Congress right there. that stands for such great history of wonderful things that have happened as well as compromised things that have happened. And the Supreme Court and the People's House, also known as the White House, and our institutions that we have right here, according to Daniel 7, will they last forever? What was said by Jesus 2,000 years ago is still true today. The time is coming when not one stone will be left upon another. Does that make a difference in how I live this next week? Oh, it sure does. And so as we review Daniel 7, he's got the four beasts, which line up from the four metals of Daniel chapter 2. We've got the four kingdoms, Babylon, Persia, Greece, and Rome. And God was on target every single time, not just that there would be four and the fourth would divide into divided Europe, but the details and the descriptions of each match the reality and the contrast of each one of those kingdoms. Let me ask you, when you look at the prophecies of Daniel and what God showed to him, does God have a plan for this world? He has a plan for this world. And if God has a plan for this world, do you think that he might have a plan for your life? And so when things are going crazy and you're confused and you're stuck in Babylon or some other place where you don't want to be, maybe you, like Daniel, can trust that God has a plan for this world. He's bigger than all the nations. They're just like a drop in the bucket compared to him. And he's got a plan for your life. And it will go best if you trust him. And so that's why we love the prophecies of Daniel. And when you look at the each of the beasts, I tell you that winged lion, as scary as he was, the winged lion was not the hero of Daniel 7. The bear, as big as he was, as much muscle as he had, he was not the hero of Daniel 7. The leopard with four wings that was so fast, four heads, was he the hero of Daniel 7? And then, of course, there's the fourth beast, which is stronger and more terrible than all of them. Was he the hero of Daniel 7? Definitely not. And this is what we have to remember, too. Because if they're not the heroes of Daniel 7, then I'm telling you today that the donkey and the elephant are not the heroes of Daniel 7 either. I know that's hard to hear on election year when all of us are looking for our hero who will stand up and save this country from disaster. But according to Daniel 7, man's not going to be able to pull it off. Things are slipping in this world. And things were slipping in Daniel 7 until somebody stood up. And so, as Americans and as citizens from any country in this world, we must always remember the prophecies of the Bible to keep ourselves in place, our country in place, and to realize where Jesus stands. Because the hero appears where Theron read in the scripture reading in verse 13 and 14. And we started here with the scripture reading, and we're going to end here at the end. When he said, I was watching in the night visions, Daniel 7, verse 13, behold one like the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Then to him was given dominion and glory, and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom, the one which shall not be destroyed. How many want to be a part of that kingdom? The Son of Man is going to stand up. And the prophecies of Daniel put all of these into its proper perspective. You realize that God is holding the world in his hands when you consider the prophecies of Daniel. Because whether you're a little boy that's helping William Tyndale smuggle Bibles illegally and risking your life to do it, whether you're a little orphan girl that's been had your parents taken away by the Seleucid armies in ancient Jerusalem, or whether you're a little American kid trying to figure life out. God's kingdom is the one that matters and that's going to last forever. And the testimony of Scripture, as you learn these stories, are the ones that will teach you what actually matters in life and what we should be aiming for. And so today we want to give our lives to God. Do you trust, as I mentioned a moment before, do you trust God's plan for your life? If you trust God's plan for your life, raise your hand. You want to follow God's plan for your life. If you want to let God be in charge of this world and calm your nerves when everything else is going crazy around us, you look at the at our country and you think, we're going crazy. You look at the world and you think, this is a dangerous place. That's right. But we have another home that God has prepared for us. And that's what Daniel realized when he lived in Babylon, is that Babylon was not actually his home. It was in Jerusalem, and most of all, it was in New Jerusalem. And for that reason, we can join those that have gone before us and realize that this world is not our home. This is not the place we're living for. We have a home up there, and that's what we're singing about in our closing hymn.
Hymn number 445. This is not our home because I am but a stranger here.
Father, today we give ourselves to you again and acknowledge that our life belongs in your hands. Just as this world belongs in your hands and the things that the people of this world do. But today we feel some measure of conviction, wanting to rebuild the altars in our home, that we may spend that time connecting with you like Daniel did. And that we may gather our children together, and we may teach them these stories and these people, that they may have a faith that when the image to the beast is built in this world and the mark of the beast, that you may have a people on the earth who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus until we see you coming in the clouds of heaven very soon. In Jesus' name. Children can receive their certificates from VBS, and Ruthie will have one to give to each one of you at the door.